At Top Gear, we look at both ends of the speed spectrum. We road test the latest French supercar, the Renault GTA, and we examine the way the advertisers present these high-performance cars to us. Are they enticing us to break the law? We also go back to school. We attend a residential driving school in the heart of Wales, and we get a lesson on driving finesse from the master himself, Jackie Stewart. But let's start with a bit of performance. We don't normally associate the name Renault in this country with high-performance cars, but this summer they've introduced a new car that puts them firmly in competition with the likes of Porsche and Lotus. It's the GTA V6 Turbo. Now, hoping, of course, it'll be a real image-maker for them. Sue Baker's been testing it on a private test track.
This is the new Renault sports car. It's the first one that Renault have imported into Britain, although they've been selling sports cars on the continent since 1961, but always with left-hand drive. Like its predecessors, the car's called the Alpine in Europe. But Renault aren't allowed to use that name in Britain because Peugeot Talbot own it here. In the small factory at Dieppe, the Alpine body shell is made in an unusual way. Plastics and glass fibre materials are moulded into over 40 separate body panels, which are glued together to make the car. First, the floor pan is bonded to the steel backbone chassis. Then the remaining panels are all glued together like a giant model kit. When the glue has set, the panels form a very rigid body shell. Only a quarter of the car's strength comes from the steel chassis. The rest comes from the body. At nearly £24,000, the car's aimed at the very wealthy, who perhaps aren't quite wealthy enough to afford real supercars like Lamborghinis and Ferraris, but who still want the head-turning ability of something spectacular. I think the car's elegant and distinctive, although it's not that pretty from the back end. The grille shows the engines at the back. It's the turbo 2.5-litre V6 that's also fitted to some versions of the Renault 25. The boot is up at the front end, but it's very small because the left-hand side is mostly occupied by the petrol tank, which looks rather vulnerable.
Inside, you do feel the benefit of the engine being so far back. It's a generous amount of room in here for a car of this type, and it's a full four-seater, although I think the passengers in the back might feel just a bit squashed at times. And it's a bit of a squash down here in the front footwell as well. For a larger footed driver, those pedals are really rather close together. It's a nicely finished and very well equipped car, though, including this highly lavish Philips stereo system here. You practically need a science degree to run that. The dashboard, I think, is a bit plasticky. There are four great big air vents, but they don't seem to push through a very high volume of air on a hot day. There is a standard trip computer and a digital fuel gauge. Unfortunately, on this particular car, we've found them to be very inaccurate.
The rear engine gives the GTA an unusual distribution of weight for a sports car. Almost two-thirds of it is over the rear wheels, which might be expected to make the car a bit unstable at times, but in practice, it feels secure up to very high cornering speeds. The only exception is that the car can hop about a bit when crosswinds are blowing on the motorway.
It's beautifully quiet for a car of this type. The engine's a long way back, the noise seems to go backwards, and it's very quiet and refined for such a high-performance car. And it is high-performance, a very exciting car to drive. As you go up through the gears, you really enjoy what it has to offer. You can go up to 90 in third, it'll go up to 120 in fourth, and the top speed is in the region of 155 miles an hour in fifth gear, if you can find anywhere in the world where you can do it.
As well as outright speed, the turbo gives the car a tremendous boost of power for very easy overtaking. And the performance compares favourably with rivals like the Porsche 944 Turbo, the Lotus Esprit and the V12 Jaguar XJS. But with a price well into the Porsche bracket, I think some buyers are going to be put off by the Renault badge on their back. The Renault GTA Turbo has a 2.5-litre, 200 brake horsepower engine. It goes from 0 to 60 in 6 seconds and on to a claimed maximum of 155 miles an hour. The price is £23,635.
Well, undoubtedly they're a high-performance car in action, driven, let me underline, on a private test track, because, of course, none of us are allowed to drive at those speeds on the open road. Although that's not the impression you get from a lot of car advertising these days. The dilemma, of course, is that whatever the limits are, there are a large number of cars around with a great deal of power and very high top speeds, and those, of course, have become the major selling points, a fact which is increasingly under attack from all sorts of road safety organisations. Chris Goffey has been looking at the problem.
Car manufacturers invest millions of pounds in design, engineering and research to make sure their products are acceptable to the buying public. But increasingly, it's the way cars are advertised and presented to the public that provides the cutting edge for the rat race of showroom sales. Last year, car manufacturers spent £185 million on advertising in the UK, and the images they've been creating have been causing problems. In recent months, a storm of protest has broken over the heads of copywriters for glamorising aggressive driving. On the offensive to put a stop to this sort of advertising approach are Friends of the Earth, cyclists and pedestrians organisations, and ROSPA, particularly as 1986 is European Road Safety Year. Most of these complaints have been fielded by the Advertising Standards Authority, who enforce the advertising industry's own code of practice. So are there more complaints about car advertising than anything else?
In the course of a year, we have a table which we call our top 10, and car advertisements come within the top three and have done for the last 6 years.
So, if somebody sees an advert that they don't like, for instance, if this appears in the Radio Times, it shows an Alfa Romeo leaping over a cliff with unbridled horsepower, what would they do?
Well, the first thing is that if they decided they didn't like the advertisement, they would write to us. We only accept complaints in writing. We don't accept them any other way.
And did anybody write to you?
Yes, we did. We got quite a few. We got them from as far away as Scotland and then down to the south coast. But we don't go on numbers. We're not at the numbers game. One complaint would be enough to trigger us off. And we check this, and what happens is when the complaint comes in, we write to the complainant, and we also write to the company, and we let them know what the complaint's about, and then ask them if they would be good enough to give us a reply, because obviously somebody must be available to defend themselves. You just don't make a decision without getting all the facts. And that's what happened in this case.
So would Alfa Romeo withdraw that advert?
Well, they were asked, the agency who prepared it, when the council of the ASA had had a look at this and decided that the complaint should be upheld against it because they believed that that wasn't the way to demonstrate the capabilities of that particular car.
But, by the time you'd gone through all this, the campaign had finished anyway, so the advert had appeared and presumably the damage had been done.
This can happen, but what does happen in most of these campaigns, they're fairly long-running. They don't just have a one-off ad. And particularly when new cars are being advertised, they go on for quite a considerable period of time. In the case of this one, we actually asked them to amend it and suggested to the agency that they could come to us for copy advice for any future copy. And that's how it was left.
So how quickly can you react to an advert that a member of the public doesn't like?
24 hours, if necessarily.
Have you noticed recently that manufacturers have started to emphasise their use of performance and acceleration in promoting their cars?
Within the last few months, we've had cause to examine them more closely. If you're going to sell a motor car, you've got to talk about its capabilities. Now, its capabilities are many, not just speed. Braking facilities, road holding, all the rest of it matters. But there has been an emphasis in recent months on speed alone. And we don't believe this is the way to approach the problem. You've got to sell motor cars, you've got to do them in an aggressive manner, we agree on this. But there are limits beyond which we believe the manufacturers and their agents shouldn't go.
So there is a watchdog body to handle complaints against the adverts that manufacturers place. But what about the people behind the adverts, the smooth, sophisticated denizens of the advertising jungle, the agency bosses who seem obsessed with high performance?
Our definition of performance is not just about high speed, it's about reliability, it's about durability, it's about going around corners, it's about mid-range acceleration. It's about a very wide range of attributes of the car. I certainly would never condone the flagrant flouting of the rules and regulations encouraging people to drive faster than 70 miles an hour. At the same time, I don't accept that a majority of advertisements are doing that, or indeed even talking about performance.
Now, the art of advertising is to jam a great deal of information into a very small space, or in the case of television, a very small time. Don't you thus tend to overemphasize the importance of speed and acceleration?
I've looked at our own advertising. We've been handling BMW for several years, and in 6 years we've done over 120 advertisements. Only 11% of those led on a performance theme, a speed theme. And in only one of those cases was a complaint upheld against us, which of course one regrets, but this is less than 1% of all the advertising we've done.
Do you think that the advertising industry ought to be doing more, especially in European Road Safety Year, to promote the safety of motor cars and the way that people drive them?
We've always tried to present safety in our advertising, quality in our advertising, and a responsible approach to speed and performance in our advertising. There have been examples which I think are inappropriate, which I've seen in European Road Safety Year, that I think are wrong, but they are a minority. I think that most car manufacturers are well aware of their responsibility, and I think most drivers are well aware of their responsibility. They are, how I would say, a pressure group who only see what they want to see, and they don't look at the full range of communication.
Well, do the critics of car advertising simply suffer from tunnel vision? Are they boring do-gooders? Or are they right that current car advertising reflects an irresponsible attitude to road safety? Rosper's safety director has no doubts on that score.
When you remember that 15 people will die on our roads today, 1,000 people will be injured to some degree or other, I think that we should be taking a much more responsible attitude to the advertising of these machines.
Now, do you think there's a link between an advert saying a car will do 120 to people having accidents at high speeds?
There's not a direct link in simply saying that a car will do 120, but if you portrayed as that's why you ought to buy this car, because it will do 120, because it will do 0 to 60 in some wonderful time, then people buy that car because that's what they want. Otherwise the people wouldn't be putting forward that in the advertisement. What I would like to see is the manufacturers and the agencies taking a more responsible line and promoting the driving of cars on our roads in a responsible way.
On the face of it, of course, that's an argument that no one can win. Safety, as we all know, is good but unglamorous, whereas it's performance that really pulls in the customers, and every car maker these days is locked in fierce competition around the world. Let's move on to servicing, something that nags at the heart of every car owner. He knows the car needs a service but doesn't want to lose it for a day. Now there's new hope for some rail travellers.
This station car park here at Maidstone is typical of thousands up and down the country, where commuters bring their cars in the morning, leave them all day, hop on the train and go up to the office. But it seems a bit of a wasted day for the car, especially if the owner then has to find other time to take it in for a service when it needs it to a garage. Why not combine the two? Well, if a new joint venture between British Rail and an organisation called Serviceman really takes off, then that will be possible. You'll be able to bring your car in, have a service, have minor repairs, have the car cleaned up, and have it still waiting for you here when you come back off the 5:45 from Charing Cross in the evening.
Serviceman was originally the brainchild of South End motor dealer Graham Govier. Graham, where did you get the idea from?
Well, I've always, and most people in the motor industry, have realised a certain number of cars being parked throughout the UK in British Rail locations. And obviously, we looked at the feasibility of offering the customer a convenient servicing operation, and obviously a British Rail car park would be extremely convenient because obviously very close to a railway station and taxi services and normal bus routes.
How many serviceman stations are there at the moment?
Well, over the last 4 years we've concentrated our development in the Essex area, and we have a total of 8 units operational there, and that's been quite deliberate to actually confine the development to the Essex area so we could actually test and market and look at the feasibility. Our plan is over the next 5 years to develop some 200 centres throughout the UK.
And what's the deal with British Rail? How do you work it as a joint venture?
First of all, the business expanded through a business format franchising, where an individual will own and operate a serviceman centre under licence. And the licence includes standard of service, attention to customers, opening hours, etc. And British Rail, as well as servicemen, earn their income from performance, from turnover, in a management service fee.
So supposing one of our viewers wanted to become one of your licensees, how much would it cost him?
Present costings are just under £50,000, including VAT, and that would be for a 10-year licence to operate the service.
The latest development for the servicemen centres is the granting of MOT approval for testing at all of the centres. So that's another inconvenient chore the new system will eliminate. Now, the latest recruit to the serviceman operation, the latest franchisee, is Alan Roberts here at Maidstone. I must say, this looks a very slick operation here. Have you had a lot of experience of the motor trade?
I was a prison officer at Maidstone up until recently.
So this is really a new venture for you?
Completely new venture.
Now, what are the sort of times of opening here? Because you're different from normal garages, aren't you?
Well, we like to cater for the commuters plus other people that need the service. So we open from 7 o'clock in the morning and open till 7 o'clock in the evening.
And weekends?
Weekends, 8 o'clock in the morning till 1 o'clock on Saturday. But if needs dictate, we will stay on later.
Seems to me that the whole concept of the serviceman operation is indicative of what's happening in the service industry today. People are at last beginning to realise that the motorist wants his car serviced at his convenience and not just when it happens to suit the garage. It's been a lesson that's taken a lot of people a long time to learn.
For most people, learning to drive is something of a challenge, and for many people, doing a couple of lessons a week over several months can become a real ordeal. One alternative these days is to do a week-long intensive residential course, and we joined such a course at a school in Wales as they were doing their start of course briefing on the Sunday evening.
Hello everybody, good evening, and welcome to the Betson School of Motoring. I'm Ray Betson, welcome. All I'm going to do this evening is just tell you quickly what's going to happen to you during the week, check your driving licences, confirm any tests that are arranged for Friday, and sort out any future tests that may have been made for you. The driving school, first of all. What's going to happen is everybody, it doesn't matter who you are, how much driving you've done, everybody is going to be brought back to absolute basics. It doesn't matter if you've taken 110 hours, if you've taken 10 tests, whether you've never driven before. You've got to go back to absolute basics so we know what problems there are and sort them out straight away. So what's going to happen tomorrow morning, 9 o'clock, we'll all go down onto the seafront in Leverbecken and be given a controls lesson. You could be given a controls lesson because the cars you may have been driving may have been Metros, Escorts, whereby all we use are Nissan Cherries. So first of all, you've got to get used to Nissan Cherries. Now, the way we work. If you were put behind the steering wheel for 5 days, from 9 till 6, you'd die a death after the first day, okay? You'd be absolutely shattered. So the way we work is two pupils in the car. The same two pupils with the same instructor in the same car all week. So what will happen? For instance, never driven before, just say, okay? You'll be taught how to move away. Clutch down, first gear, set your gas, observation, indication, handbrake, go. You'll do it, stop. Do it, stop, do it. 3 or 4 times, 5, 10 minutes, stop, then change over. And the next person will then do the same thing over the same route with the same instruction. 10 minutes later, change over, you do it again. Bingo, you can move away safely under control. So in effect, you're not really learning off the person who's driving. What's happening? You're being brainwashed. You're hearing the same thing again and again and again and again until you do it and it's natural.
There's your curb, we'll keep with the curb, 2 to 3 feet off the curb. Have a quick check to your right, are we all clear?
Yeah.
Concentrate on your left now. Transfer your foot to the gas and just a little gas, not too much now. Try not to snatch the wheel back, nice and gently. Don't forget, if you react too much with the steering, the car will react as well, okay?
The rest of the week, again, they're starting off at 9 o'clock, working through to 6. All of the time being spent on the road, apart from the break from 11 to 11.30 and lunch from 2 till 3. The idea of the course is based upon short, sharp repetition, whereby the individual pupil spends 10-15 minutes doing a certain manoeuvre, then they change over. And this happens for the remainder of the week, for the 4 days. A lot of the time is also spent on manoeuvres, getting them to an acceptable standard for Department of Transport test.
I first took a driving lesson back in 82, May 82, and I took about 5 lessons in all, but during the 4th lesson, my driver shouted at me, and I was quite put off. He smoked in the car as well, which I didn't much enjoy. So I gave up.
The great attraction which it has for me is the fact that it's concentrated into 1 week, and it gives not only the tuition element but the practice. This is where I think I fell down previously. 1 lesson a week or 2 lessons a week without any practice in between just isn't good enough. You need to have
practice under road conditions, varying traffic conditions and so forth. And I'm hoping that that's what this course is going to provide. So far, it seems quite encouraging.
I failed my test last year, last February, and up till then I hadn't actually failed at anything I'd done. And I lost all confidence in myself and driving, and I hadn't driven since then. I decided to come here. I'm treating it more as an activity holiday, but the job I do doesn't actually allow me time to have conventional driving lessons. They are here, out there. I think this is more beneficial in that respect. And this morning's been super.
I learnt this way many years ago in the army. There were four or five of us thrown in the back of a Land Rover and sent out all week, and we all took that test on the Friday afternoon. All I have done is just adapt it for civilians, but keeping obviously down to two pupils in a car and driving cars, saloon cars, rather than army Land Rovers.
If you're at home, you could take a lesson once a week, because I don't like driving after work, I'm so tired. So coming here, I can concentrate on that, do the test if possible on Friday and see how it goes. So that's the reason why I came, really. And I think with having other people in the same boat, you know, it helps, because you can discuss and chat to them how things are going.
You're doing fine. Really good. Okay. Now we're going to stay in first and second gear for a while.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of part vehicles, we're in a very narrow road, yeah?
The cost of the course up until April 87 is £250 plus VAT, and that is fully inclusive of bed, breakfast, evening meal and all of the driving tuition for the week. From April 87 onwards, it's £299 plus VAT, the same thing. For the younger person, the 17 to 25, 30 year old group, even if they've never driven, then we can usually achieve about a 70% pass rate. Our highest pass rate is obviously with those people who are failing the test on nerves, who have taken multiple tests before, and what they need is that bit of polish and the bit of confidence, and it's those people who seem to do very well on the course.
Well, I'm sure you'll be interested in the results of that week. Of the people on the course, four decided to take the test, two passed, two failed. Dr. Tina Mater unfortunately failed yet again and will take the test again later on. Judy Hollis unfortunately had an attack of nerves during the test and withdrew completely. I'm sure we all wish her the best of luck next time. Let's move on now from one end of the spectrum to the other, from the would-be driver to the maestro himself, Jackie Stewart, three times Formula One world champion. He's recently distilled the essence of his years of experience into a new book called The Principles of Performance Driving. It's packed with information from end to end, but the heart of the matter seems to be what Jackie calls finesse driving. Nothing rough or jerky, everything smooth and measured. We managed to lure him down to Brands Hatch to give us a practical demonstration.
Jackie, can you tell us what you mean by this word finesse that you use in the book?
When you drive a car, whether it be on the road or on the track, you've got to be very smooth always at all times. In other words, if I'm going on the throttle now, it drew its corner, I'm now fully on the throttle because I started off progressively applying it. So you didn't feel it going to full throttle. Now I'm at full throttle right now. I'm heading along the bottom straight here behind the pits at Brands Hatch. I'm coming off the throttle gently, gently brushing the brakes. I'm back on the throttle now and I'm at full throttle. Braking gently, down a gear, turning the car in gently, not throwing the car into the corner. Now my knuckles are not all white on the steering wheel, it's a fingers and thumbs touch. I'm not hanging on. This steering wheel was made to change the direction of the car, not as a grab handle, so there's no great effort used on the steering wheel. It's a delicate movement. The manner in which you address your car in the relationship to acceleration and braking is a secret to all good driving. It's how smoothly you do it. If you see the great drivers, Jim Clark, Stirling Moss, Fangio before them, if you think of Niki Lauda, Alain Prost, Nelson Piquet today, they're very smooth, very gentle with their cars. They don't look spectacular, but they are the fastest.
But how much of that is really applicable to road driving? Because, of course, the priorities and the conditions on the road are so different from the racetrack.
Well, if for a moment I just slow the car down a little bit more towards road speed, If I'm going towards Druids Corner now and I was going towards a normal right-hand bend in the road, if suddenly I just did, oh, and cranked the car over too abruptly, I would be thrown over to this side. If my passengers on board would all be tossed to one side, it would be an extremely uncomfortable experience. It's unnecessary. If I were just, on the other hand, to change the direction of the car by gently and slowly turning the steering wheel to begin with, they would get used to the G-forces that would be coming through that corner. Their bodies would be braced gently and slowly, and then they would have everything in place and I could turn the car into the corner and go round it much faster than they in fact ever thought they would be going round that corner. So it's very deceptive. If you have any sudden sharp movement in a car, whether it's through braking or acceleration, again, that surge comes. If I go into second gear right now, and suddenly I go like that, off the throttle and on the throttle, look, we're getting jumping back and forward. The passengers are the same. I consider that my responsibility as a road driver is to be the ideal chauffeur. I want to be able to drive away from the curb or the traffic lights without my passengers ever feeling like they've been driven away from a standing start. I want to be able to change gear smoothly and gently without them feeling the lurch. I can go up through the box or down through the box and you don't feel the gear changes.
You've got this demonstration thing, Jackie, called, you know, the ball in the basket. What's that all about?
The whole idea of that was it's very difficult for me to get someone to believe that they're not a wonderful driver. What happens is that they say, I've been driving for 40 years, I'm a great driver, I've never had an accident. Little do they know that everyone's been avoiding them for 40 years. So I have to show them visually, and I have this ball in the dish. If you drive around this simple course very smoothly, very gently, the ball will stay in the dish. If you accelerate too abruptly or brake too abruptly, ball comes out the dish. Keeping the ball, of course, at all times in the dish, being as smooth and gentle as one can in change of direction, clearly you've got to let the throttle off gently, get it round a corner like this here very progressively, and then you come back to a standing start, keeping the ball in the dish. Now, of course, it looks fairly easy. It's not a fast test, but there's a lot of pressure because you do it against the clock. I set a target time, and then it's up to you, of course, to beat my target time. It can be done, it has been done before, but it's not an easy test. But it is, in the essence, finesse in driving. Gentle progression with the throttle, the brakes, and the steering wheel.
You've only got to make a sort of cack-handed gear change, or wind on too much bank, or dab those brakes, and the wretched ball pops out of the dish. And all the time, of course, you're conscious of the magic time of 18 seconds that Jackie says you can do it in. Whoops. Well, it isn't all that easy. I think I'm going to go away and get some secret practice and have a competition with Chris Goffey with eggs. That's really all for tonight's programme. Next week, we've got our usual mixed bag. We've got our road test on the Audi 80. We look at what's happened to garages. They're becoming regular corner shoppies with all that merchandise they're selling. And we look at some lovely Ferraris. So see you then. Usual time of 8:30. Till then, drive safely. Good night.